Well, just to finish up quickly, I just feel like it, you know, eventually came back as thinking of sort of more of the long-term thing. And, you know, eventually you just cope and start going back to work again, you know. And I think that's, there's a rededication, I think, that I've been feeling. So that's all I can say.
Thanks, Cynthia. Mm-hmm. James, would you be willing to go next? James, you got your mute on.
Sorry about that. I have a lot of conversations. I'm on the board of a Unitarian church, so they're, of course, doing a lot of soul searching, trying to figure out how to be relevant as progressives, kind of here in the far west coast in a small town. A lot of interesting experience, a lot of interesting thoughts. I had a meeting with about 60 mediators and people who are taking mediator training, and pitched Scott's book fairly heavily, and people were very interested in it. I think my sense is that the web and my circle of contacts is, there's really been a coalescence around this question now about dialogue. A couple of years ago, or even before the election, I would talk about how the quality of the discourse was inadequate to the challenge of the time. Framing of it, and people would go, what? And now I say that, and people immediately get it. They just, and I guess my sense is that any form of representative government, if we're not going to give up on that, whether it's democracy, republic, or anything else, is ultimately over the hearts and minds of the people. And so the dialogue work, I also went through that period of what's the point of this stuff now? You know, we just have to fight, blah, blah, blah. And I, you know, within a few days or a week, I was back to, you know, we really don't have any choice but to get to know those people. And so I really like Strangers in Their Own Land. That's one of the books I've read since then. And I thought it was very powerful. And I've seen several examples on the web of Bernie Sanders and Van Jones and some other people really quite elegantly reaching out to Trump voters in ways that made a lot of sense to them. And, just one more thing, I guess that my favorite thing about the Strangers in Their Own Land book was her deep story, where she summarizes what the Tea Party's folks that she had gotten to be friends with, genuine friends with in Louisiana, how they saw the world. And she had the unusual academic courage to go back and talk to them to make sure she got it right. And she did. And it's very, very powerful. And I think we need to do that with all sorts of ideologies and perspectives. It made it gettable and quite terrifying. So it's probably enough for me.
Yeah, I'd love you if you could write that book down in our shared space, if you know how to do that.
Sure. Well, I think so.
You can always just move your screen over. And for any of you, you'll notice that there's a underlying screen if you move your screen over. And each of us have a different color that is used when we write something there. So we can actually take shared notes that way. So when something comes up like that, go ahead and feel free to use that. Or if there's any notes you do want to take, I'd encourage you to do that. Although we are now recording, so that'll help.
Could I second that real quick, just to say that I really like it when a lot of times people have good little ideas and it's not really worth interrupting the whole crew. And I would really appreciate it if you would just jot that down, because it's a way for us to sort of archive a lot of small pieces of information that can make a big difference for us.
Yes, and how you find it is you can always go back to it. You just click on the event and it'll take you right to it. So it never goes away. It'll always be there for any of us. Do any, let me see a show of hands if you've never used it and you don't know how to get over to it. I could take just a moment to show you. Okay, so all you need to do is make sure that your screen is not on, it doesn't take up your whole screen, okay?
Okay, I have two monitors.
Okay, so do you see the other screen, Larry?
Yeah. I don't know what it is I'm supposed to be seeing, though.
Well, you see under, there's just a big page there that's blank. It says, hey there, use this space to summarize key insights. Do you see that?
No,
I don't see it either on mine. Let's see.
You move. I see the so expected.
If you move your Zoom screen over to the right, you'll see this large blank piece. It says administrative controls, and then there's just a big box. You all see that?
No, sorry, I don't.
Okay, let's see, do we have a chat button here? That's the other way we can do it. Well, if there's something, if for those of you who don't see it and can't do it, just send me what you'd like to share, and then I'll make sure that I get it on the screen. How's that?
Okay. Sure.
I think you all have my emails. Okay, well, I hope I'm not putting you on the spot, Stephen, but you're next on my go-around list. Why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself, and what's on your mind these days?
Can you hear me?
Is my mic? Yes. Okay. You sound great.
Barely.
Scott invited me.
Yeah, maybe if you can increase your volume a little bit, that would be helpful.
I don't know how to do that.
Just speak up. We can hear you.
All right. Yeah, Scott invited me because I think he thought I might provide some viewpoints or insights or something that maybe don't get heard here as much.
Yes, Stephen has a more conservative background, and so Scott was nice enough to suggest he come on. You're not, as I understand, a process person like we are. Maybe say just a little bit about what you do so we can kind of...
All right, well, okay. Real rough background is...
And let's try to all mute ourselves unless we're speaking. I do hear some...
I have a degree in mechanical engineering and a master's degree in management, and I've been in program management in one way or another pretty much my whole career, which started in 1983. And being involved in this sort of thing is sort of an avocation. It's just, it's a hobby, it's an interest. You could say, I think Scott would vouch for, it's a rather passionate one, but it's something I've been involved in for a while. And this all sort of came together. The backstory is, a long time ago, I watched a video by Jonathan Haidt, which I hope some of you are familiar with, and sent him an email and he liked it. And long story short, I'm one of the names in the acknowledgments of the Righteous Mind as people who gave him feedback as he was putting that book together. And I've and through that, and my involvement in discussions online, none through video, but by typing messages back and forth, I was introduced to Scott, and so I've been conversing with him ever since too.
Very cool. Thanks for that connection. That really helps us kind of place your interest. All right, Deb, would you be willing to go next?
Sure. I don't really know what the question was. I got a phone call in the middle of all of this. Maybe I should ask that first.
Well, we're just introducing ourselves, where we're from, maybe a little bit about you, what draws you into this conversation, and anything you'd like to share, just what's going on with you on this subject, if you have any thoughts, questions, anything that's juicy that you'd like to get the group to think about, just whatever you'd like to start with or share.
In 2 minutes or less, right?
No, let's take time. We're just going to do one check-in round, so you can speak a little bit longer this time.
So I'm Deb Blakesley. I live in Tacoma, Washington. I have been concerned for maybe about a decade about our democratic, or actually longer than that, but the pieces started forming together, and in my last 10 years have led me to, I believe we need a formal community listening system where we go door to door, ask people what their concerns are, identify root causes and potential solutions, and then take those recommendations to our elected officials, because my research shows that they ain't coming to us. And that goes beyond us white people who have access to privilege and whatnot. So I really didn't want to come on this call because I'm not interested in the political divide I think that to the extent that we concentrate our concerns are, I think some of the divide goes away if we're really concentrating on what concerns are and how to improve them. So that's my focus. And so if I can slant people to concentrating on concerns rather than worrying about the political divide, there are some people who are just, will do that. So so that's my short story, and that's, I'm sticking to it.
Okay. I'd love to hear more about what you're doing. That sounds really, really interesting. Nancy, why don't you go next?
Okay. I'm still trying to get on. I'm just on my cell phone right now, which is a little awkward. I'm not able to get on the regular computer yet. I totally agree with what you were saying, Deb. I've also gotten in touch with the fact that if we ask deep enough questions for which we don't think we already know the answers, and we're trying to convince each other of those answers, they're actually inquiry of some really difficult questions that we all face. And then the focus is on the substance rather than on coming together in or just in order to come together, but rather coming together to work together on a problem that is framed in such a way that it actually captures the concerns of all sides, if you will. That said, I'm in Santa Cruz, California, which is a mostly progressive community, less progressive than it likes to think itself as being, but still it's very, very much the dominant culture here. And the mood ever since the election has been one of organizing for resistance. And very few people are talking about bridge building, or if they are, they're talking about it merely rhetorically. They're not building it into their thinking at all about what to do or where to go. Or so I'm feeling really glad for the group here today, because I haven't found yet a very fruitful place to have this conversation. I'm also concerned, frankly, that gearing up with this notion of protesting on the day of the inauguration and the rest of it is both ironically reinforcing the idea of many people in this country that the people on the liberal coasts don't care about what happens to the people in the middle of the country. I recently lived in Ohio for a couple of years, and that really helped me as well. I'm concerned that it will all be written off, just being poor sports and unwilling to accept the democracy, that in a sense it's, anyhow, you get the gist of what I'm saying. So I'm feeling kind of at a loss right now as to how to move forward with the concerns I have. So I'll leave it at that.
Thanks.
And I'm really particularly there is one other thought. Stephen, I'm really grateful for your presence here, and Deb, for your clarity in framing it. I want to say the other question that comes up for me that is challenging. There are a few people in our community that I would view, that are viewed as more conservative, that I am reaching out to, and I have connections with them. So I'm hoping to sit down with them and talk about what we might do. But the other question that comes up for me, I'm very interested in the transpartisan movement and those who on various sides of the political spectrum at least feel that talking to each other across those divides is really an essential thing to be doing and are willing to put the effort into figuring out how to do it, versus feeling that it's an utter waste of time. Why should people, quote, on the other side talk to each other, which is part of the underlying mood that is so unsettling? So thoughts about that. As I said, the closest I've gotten is just ignore, as Deb was saying, just ignore the whole divide question as such, and rather frame questions that are so gripping in their own right, like for example, if jobs go away, what do we do for income? Seems to me that's a pretty fundamental question for which we actually don't have any really ready answers. Okay. There.
Thanks, Nancy. All right. Let's hear from Lloyd, if that's okay with you.
Oh, boy. Okay, I wish I'd had a chance to listen to a little bit more, but where I am on it is that I actually welcomed, after I got over the shock of the election, I welcomed what had happened because I think we really needed some disjuncture in our society, a break, because both sides have been so sure that they're right. And if anything, I think I could almost fault the liberals more than the conservatives for what has happened. An insight that I had yesterday looking at election results, that liberals generally have an air of intellectual superiority. And if you're that smart, why aren't you getting elected? Because if you look at the election results over the last 30 years, liberals have not done a very good job at all. And both, I mean, it was so clear in this election cycle that both parties were very elitist. During the primaries, I thought that, my impression of Trump was I wasn't sure I'd ever encountered anyone who was less aware and more arrogant. Then we discovered that both political parties at the upper ranks were populated by the same sorts of people who were very unaware and very arrogant. And one thing that I don't think that the liberals have recognized is the malevolence of segments of the right over the last 30 to 40 years. I don't know whether they recognize. I really think that hate radio has much to do with what's happening in this country. I mean, we have a steady stream of hate 24 hours a day, any place in the country. You can listen to that. And the other thing that the approach I'm taking, and I'm enlisting some people to work on a book, is I think the most important thing, the most effective thing we can do is to share our stories with each other and to tell our stories. And I fault the media for that. We have abdicated our position of telling our stories. The media tells it, journalists, Hollywood, politicians, and they have a very vested interest in us being weak, because we're then ceding our power, power to them. And particularly in the political realm, they've reduced us to one dimension or less, and reduced it to just very few select values, and issues aren't connecting people in any way. And so I think the most effective thing we can do is to recover our voices and share our stories. And that's true for everyone. I mean, I read Arlie Russell Hochschild's book, Strangers in Their Own Land. And I was really amazed at the story that she told there, or impressed with her empathy. And if you're not familiar with the book, she spent 5 years getting to know 40 Tea Party people in Louisiana. And the book came out of a conversation that she had with one of her graduate students at Berkeley. And she was pondering what she calls the great American paradox, which is that those people who are the most conservative and in the states that are the poorest are the most opposed to federal programs. And those people are in the states that have experienced the most environmental devastation are the ones most opposed to regulation.
Huh.
And this graduate student is from Louisiana, and she said, you need to meet my mother. My mother is a progressive, and her best friend is a Tea Party member. So that gave Hasha the opening there. And what she found was, and I've since read other places too, that government absolutely and utterly failed those people there. They have no reason whatsoever to trust the government to do anything for them. And another journalistic venture that caught my eye was a couple weeks ago, Rolling Stone had two interviews in it. One was the outgoing interview with Obama, and the other one was just an interview with Bernie Sanders. And the two men live in totally different countries. In the country that Obama lives in, the economy is doing well. People have jobs. And the Democrats' primary failure was to let people know how well they were doing. And that the culture wars have had a profound impact on the election. In the country that Bernie Sanders lives in, and remember, he comes from Vermont, which is a rural state. It is not a liberal state, never has been. And in the world that Bernie Sanders lives in, many people are economically at risk. And what he has found in Vermont, as long as he lets people know, as long as he communicates with people and lets them know that he recognizes the issues about economic stability in their lives, that they're giving him a pass on the culture issues. The culture issues don't matter at all to them. So there's an awful lot of talking to be done out there. I think it all starts with our stories. I'm complete.
Thanks, Lloyd. Who's the author of that book? It's been mentioned twice now. I'll get it up on the screen.
Arlie Russell Hochschild.
Arlie, A-R-L-Y?
A-R-L-I-E.
And the last name?
H-O-C-H-S-C-H-I-L-D.
Okay, I'll get that up on the screen.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much. David, would you be willing to go next?
Sure. Hi, can you all hear me?
Oh.
Yes, we can.
Okay, great.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. Yes, there are two. I'm sorry.
There's two Davids.
David
Which
Sachs.
David did you mean?
I actually meant David Sachs. You're right on. Go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I appreciate it. And I really appreciate this call. It's really speaking to a lot of issues and things I've been thinking about and feeling since the election, but also going back years observing our political dialogue. I come from Chevy Chase, Maryland, and I'm a clinical psychologist and an educator. I work with doctoral students in clinical psychology as well as psychotherapy patients. And I have, was really in shock from the election and decided that whatever I was doing, supposedly doing good in my thinking for the world was far from enough. And had been interested in the dialogue probably as a result of, you know, my role as a sort of mediator type in my family of origin. But I proceeded to take a training with Essential Partners in Boston in reflective structured dialogue, which was a 3-day affair. I had seen on their website Bridging the Red-Blue Divide, which was a new publication they had put out, because they've been in business for some 20 years working on dialogue issues and civic issues. And among the 24 participants in that 3-day training, there were a number who had signed up right, you know, quickly since the election, concerned about the state of the dialogue in our public life. So what I have been trying to do is, I don't consider myself an experienced practitioner of dialogue, But what I would like to see are more dialogues with diversity, first of all, on my college campus or my university psychology training program. And there have been some of those during the past year on issues like in the wake of the Orlando shootings and related to relations between police and communities of color, in the diversity classes on campus. We're going to hold one post-election coming soon on the 25th of this month. That is going to be, although it's a large group, it's going to be in a dialogue kind of format and open to diverse points of view. I would like to continue that work, deepen it, expand it, and work in a community setting as well. And I have, am well aware that I'm in the Washington, D.C. area and would love to, you know, have people at various levels of Republicans and Democrats dialogue with one another and see how much of that can take place. I have been reading in the New America Foundation, that certain issues like climate change and sentencing for in criminal justice system have had coalitions in the past that have crossed party lines and in fact united people at ideological extremes. And this is a fascinating idea to me. So I would like, as a practical matter, one question that I have for the group is, how do I find more Trump supporters and conservatives who are actually interested in dialogue at this point in time? Because if you feel like you're kind of in the driver's seat politically, why do you want a dialogue? So that's one kind of practical issue that I have. And then echoing what several of the others have been saying, this idea among many of my kind of liberal friends and acquaintances, that resistance is what it's all about, that it's not a time for dialogue, that we live in a time when, you know, if...
Oh, your screen may have frozen. David, we can't hear you. So if your screen, what you might want to do if you can hear us is to jump off and then come back on. Do a refresh. So we're going to move on because we can't hear you right now, David. Ooh, sorry. Scott, why don't you go ahead? Oh, there he is. Dave, you're back. Okay, go ahead.
Am I back? Okay,
you're back.
Sorry.
Yeah. No problem.
All right. So I am concerned about what I am hearing on the left about fight, 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 and about resistance. And I would, you know, welcome further thoughts on that issue as well.
Thank you. Wonderful, wonderful framing. Okay, Scott, why don't you take it? And you're on mute. Scott, you are on mute.
Yeah, gotcha. Thank you. Sorry about that. Scott Wagner is my name, and I'm the author of The Liberal's Guide to Conservatives. I was here on the first meeting and just wanted to come back. This is wonderful stuff to try to wrestle with. My friend Steve Messenger, who's here, failed to mention that I recorded my audio version at his in his closet in his living room. And just kind of waded through the Dulles Airport flights floating over, you know, and things. But anyway, David Sachs, I'm really glad that you spoke right before me. You had two questions. You wanted to ask how to attract more conservatives into the dialogue process. And I would just like to submit that a good way of sort of reframing the question a little bit, and I'll admit it's radical, but it's just the notion of forget dialogue and talk about listening and talk about specifically asymmetrical listening. In other words, if you want conservatives to show up, a way for them to be motivated to show up is that there are going to be a bunch of liberals that are there that will actually listen to them about their actual complaints. And, you know, I would extend that in work that I'm trying to do of the notion of, and not bitching, and not establishing some kind of tit for tat type of situation where you think that it's going to be 50-50 in any way you care to name. And this is just a very simple marketing point, really. So it's not philosophical, right? I'm not trying to make some kind of philosophical point here. I'm saying if you want more of them to show up, then tell them that there will be a bunch of liberals there that are just listening. And it's that simple. The other thing that you mentioned is what I think of as a false dichotomy, and I think that many of us really need to think about this, and Cynthia touched on this, a couple of other people have too. It's this notion of, oh, do we resist or do we have dialogue? Well, I have all kinds of reasons why I might want to dialogue, but they're pretty much the same as the resistance reasons, okay? Yeah, I want my side to win. I also want a lot of clarity to happen. I want things to be efficient, you know, no matter who wins. It's not appropriate for us to think, in my opinion, in terms of resistance versus dialogue. I feel like dialogue is absolutely essential. And I go into that elsewhere for a lot of different reasons, but I live to resist, you know, and Steve knows this. I'm an activist, okay? I'm deeply opposed to a lot of things that happen on the conservative side, and I will fight and I will be arrested, you know, and speak in ways that are off-putting to many conservatives. So this is that sort of dichotomy that I think that many of us just, you know, it doesn't mean that everybody has to do both. I'm just saying, you know, don't moralize one or the other, and don't get hung up in trying to decide what society should do, but settle, like Cynthia was kind of inferring for herself and a couple of others of us, you know, just kind of settle into what this means for you and decide on that basis, you know, but don't assume that one side is better than the other or whatever, and those things. Anyway, happy to be here. Thanks.
Thanks, Scott. Mm-hmm. What I'm almost hearing you say, if I could just make a quick comment, is try to find that sweet spot of authenticity, because that's what people are really looking for, I think, these days. You know, because both dialogue, where it has that edge to it of wanting to be right, of course, I wouldn't call that dialogue, but some people do. It's just as bad as resistance, if you hear what I'm saying. But if we can just show up and be authentic. And not try to push our views necessarily, but really show up as authentically as we can, I think. And tell our stories, too. Our stories always help. Somebody else mentioned that. Thank you. All right, let's go back to you, David. David Friedley. And I can unmute you.
Sure. All right. I guess to pick up on the topic of resistance for a second. I hear all the left and progressive talk about resistance, and I don't know. To me, it's a turnoff. I'm like, it's like you're repeating the problem of you're not listening and you're still not listening. I don't know. But just general, I'd say when I'm getting barraged by a lot of stuff about resistance and. And to me, that's a real turnoff. So I don't know. So that's what I have to say about that. But I'm here because I'm working on because I'm programming. In fact, I've been doing a lot of programming since we last talked. But I'm building a website for deliberative discussion online. And I know there's doubts about whether or not you can make it work online. And my opinion is I'm just going to keep working on it until it works. But I feel like the only way that we're going to sort of fix these things is by making it work at scale. At scale and across geographies. But we just can't compete with all of the negativity and all of the sort of polarization that's coming out of Twitter and Facebook. And we need something different. We need something that, something that's based on what works and what brings people together rather than what drives ratings. And so that's my look at this. And Scott, I really appreciate what you just said about how to attract conservatives to the conversation, because I have a lot of trouble attracting conservatives to the conversation, and I know it's, you know, some of it's the wording, and you just have to be really conscious of the wording. I think a lot of that wording thing goes even further into what's happening in the media even now and the resistance is that, people are wording things to make people emotional, either, emotional in their favor or to piss them off, depending on what they're talking about. And I interesting, I was talking to my son who just graduated from high school and went to college, but I was talking about, we need marriage counseling. So in marriage counseling, they teach you about all the words that you say that piss off your spouse, and the way that you talk about what you need and what you're feeling and not about what your wife did or what you think her motivations are. I think, America needs political marriage counseling right now, because we're really just going at it. And David Sacks, my father was a clinical psychologist. So I grew up with that. I was raised, actually, my mom's a psychologist too, so I was raised by psychologists. But anyway, that's, I guess, my short story, and I've been really head down in the programming. I'm kind of worried about the future, but I'm building stuff right now. In a couple of weeks, I might send something out for you guys and do a demo or something. But that's where I'm at.
Thanks, David. Courtney, would you like to go?
Sure. So I think for me, in the time since our last call, there's been a lot of energy and movement to do more work, to expand knowledge and visibility of dialogue, and that there can be productive ways of engaging with one another across various differences and divides and what have you. In work-wise, for NCDD, one of the most recent things we did was, spur of the moment, we organized a host training for Conversation Cafe. We did a introduction to Conversation Cafe call just before the holidays on the 19th, which had a lot of interest. And following that, we just kind of felt inspired, should we hold a quick training to show people how to host these conversations? And what I found most noteworthy was the announcement about this went out, I believe, on the 23rd, the 22nd or the 23rd of December. And we held the training on January 3rd. So all of the messaging that went out was just right smack in the middle of the holidays. But we had almost 90 people register.
Wow.
And and a lot of those were folks in our network, but not all of them. And it was a really broad range of people, and it just told me how it reiterated what my own instinct was, which is there's a lot of people out there that just want to know how can I engage with others in a different way, because the way that we've been doing things, I don't want to do that anymore. I want a different kind of way of talking with people. And so that's kind of my, that's given me my renewed sense of purpose that I felt like I needed, after the election, cause I definitely felt a bit lost at that point personally. But I think it's also reminded me that we really, I brought this up on the last call, that we really do need to make a concerted effort to bring in, more various perspectives as we talk about this work and what we can do and how we can work collectively. And I'm sorry to say that those I had reached out to, I had reached out to a couple of colleagues who have more conservative viewpoints and can offer better perspective on engaging with conservatives, which is something I'm very interested in. And they couldn't make it today, but they both, two of them expressed a lot of interest in being a part of this conversation. So Linda, hopefully they can join us next time.
Great. Absolutely. Wonderful. Thanks, Courtney. Wish I had done that Conversation Cafe training.
It's recorded. I can send it to you.
Good, good, good. Yeah. And let's see. I have missed. Oh, maybe she's. Oh, there you are. I don't know your first name. Shapiro. You're on mute.
Laura.
All right.
So I was on the last conversation, and it was, I'm relatively new to this organization, and I'm so thrilled to have the resources and opportunity to speak with people. So very much in learning mode, you know, I just feel on so many levels that dialogue is part of such important work. I think I mentioned last time that a colleague and I, before the election and starting in the summer, we named ourselves Democrats Willing to Listen, and we went door to door to Trump homes, and we were a little concerned about feeling like we're invading people's privacy, but we found mostly people were just very willing to talk, and we did take this approach. We just want to listen, you know, help us understand where you're coming from, and that was very powerful, challenged a lot of my assumptions. I also felt silenced in that process and really wanted an opportunity to be listened to also, so I hope that's coming. So how that's morphed, we are going to start going back to some of the people we met to see if we can continue listening and maybe invite some of their friends to dialogue. We found some openings for that. So what we're doing now, because, you know, I'm learning and doing and we're learning and doing, bumbling our way through this, but it still feels like we have to practice this dialogue process and listening process. So we have a study group using some of the chapters from Dialogue and Deliberation, and we're just beginning to even share our differences around that and some of the issues that were mentioned here today, you know, in terms of, you know, should we just be talking, or, you know, the resistance and action. So in that conversation about the value of dialogue and what it is, it's been interesting just to practice listening to differences around that. And hopefully, so we'll gain some skills, and the idea is that people in this group will, you know, maybe have some conversation cafes. We're very locally focused in our own county. Literally, we feel that we want to build our strength of our neighbors through dialogue. So we'll see where it goes. I'm intrigued by the idea of moving from just talking about talking, although I think that's really important, to what are some of the issues emerging in our county. It's quite a diverse county. We live in Rockland County, quite a diverse county. So some more conservatives are joining our study group, and so that should be great. So again, thanks for this opportunity for learning.
Thanks, Laura. I'm hearing an awful lot of background and I can't trace it. David, it might be you, I'm not sure, but I see that you are, this is David Sachs I'm referring to, but you are on mute, but I'm just hearing a lot of background noise, so not sure what to do about that, but anyways. So I think we are ready to hear from Larry. Larry Victor, my neighbor in Tucson. And you are on mute, Larry.
No, okay. I thought I had attended the first, but I realized it was a dialogue prior to the first that I had, and I had missed the first dialogue of this topic. For five decades, I have been a critic of the context of the various movements that I was a participant in, and put them into historical context as to everybody was believing a reality that was mostly accidental. The Trump campaign, or the entire campaign of 2016, surprised me at the beginning, but then as I saw it unfolding, I was realizing that there was a stripping away of a lot of the clothes that the curtains that were hiding the realities that everybody was coming from. And I was not surprised by Trump's election, because the election was won by those who could manipulate the process the best. And democracy is a fraud when we have such uneducated and incompetent persons in the general population on the issues that we were really talking about. What surprised me, however, was the very rapid shifting in the means of expression of people on both, across the spectrum, as a result of the Trump victory. I found entire websites shifting from a kind of a neutral language to a vitriolic language. Just overnight, certain commentators that I had respected for many years suddenly shifted into a language that repulsed me. And it was surprising me as what had happened. A number of close friends have been reporting their positions, which surprised me very much. People I would not expect highly supporting Trump. And I realized as I listened to them and listened to people comment that it was reinforcing my belief about humankind is that we are not persons in a common world. We are all worlds interacting with each other. And whatever you are experiencing, you are experiencing yourself, and that each person constructs a world for themselves. They don't do it deliberately. It really emerges during their lifetime, made up of the input, the language, the customs, the cultures that they're within, and that's real to them. That means every person out there is acting the best they can and are moral in the sense of the world that they're within. They might not be successful, they might be, but if they blame somebody, it's because they consider that person to be objectively causing them trouble. And as I began to see in the election, I was really concerned about Trump, who is a very unique character, and many people don't really realize how truly psychologically deranged that man is and unable to function. And it surprises me that so many people aren't following that, because that's not the information they perceive. But the dialogue to me needs to be, I mean, obviously at the foundation, human beings interacting with human beings is what we build up from. But the context by which we do our dialogues greatly distorts and contorts the kind of dialogue we have. The money, a bunch of our dialogue reinforces fictions. And that if somehow we could begin to learn a means of dialoguing as worlds interacting with world, we might begin to make some headway. But I cannot make any headway out of the reason why we are letting one man dictate this nation. I mean, that's what we're doing. Why does the system let that happen? What has happened to the system? My concern is that the polls don't come off and we don't have a system. That I want us to compare the United States of America with North Korea, objectively. There's certain people living well, certain people not living well, but if you really boil it down, every nation is caught in its own ideological trap today. And I don't see any, you know, objectivity out of it. We have to be doing things at many levels simultaneously. Different people, different teams. And the interrelationships between the different doings of groups and people is maybe as important as the things that they're doing. Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Larry. So I'd like to just say a little bit more about what I'm doing and then let's just open it up for regular dialogue. Good segue, Larry, to what I wanted to say, because I just had the opportunity this week to do some work with my old business partner, Glenna Girard. We filmed a little piece we're going to put on the website and promoting our new training, virtual training on dialogue. And you know, after that was all done, we just kind of shot the breeze for a while. And we both said the same thing in different ways, that, you know, mostly what goes on for dialogue these days is not true what we call bone dialogue, because we never have enough time, really. And we don't have the continuity of people to go really deep. And yet that, in some ways, from my point of view, with all the election craziness out there, that's what we need to do. I mean, you know, I think one of the reasons we have these, Larry, these dictatorships and someone like a Trump coming into being who might be more authoritarian is because we're looking for fast answers, because if we don't have time for dialogue, we don't really get at the root of our problems, and we look for quick answers, and we look for someone who says, yeah, let's make America great again. I mean, sounds great, you know, on the surface, but what we really need is we all need to take a deep dive down to see what are the roots of some of these things that, like climate change, I've been doing that for 2 years now, and I've never yet had a really satisfying, deeply satisfying conversation on climate change. So at the same time that our world is speeding up and is giving us more and more complex, sticky, horrible, wicked issues, we go out and we start to resist what is without still doing the work. So what I just did personally was I finally, I'm a little bit afraid because I've never done this before, but I finally put out a notice in my community. I live in a little 2,000 to 4,000, depending on the season, population area. It's a little art village in southern Arizona. And I'm putting out that I'm doing a bone dialogue conversational group where I really want to take a deep dive into the issues. I have no idea who's going to show up. I'm just publicly putting it out there. So we'll see. I'll report on that next time. It'll be the first time I've done this. So I want to see who shows up. And I'm hoping that I can get commitment. It's going to be a once a week group, and I'm hoping for 2 hours, and I'm hoping if I can get enough continuity, you know, and we're going to do it for 4 months, it might be pretty interesting. So I'll let you know how that works. Well, I have noticed a few questions that have been raised that seem maybe to kick us off with about getting the conservative view out. And I guess I'd like to put this right to Steve, our one person who is on the call with us, who we know is bringing a more conservative point of view. So from your point of view, you know, what makes it interesting to talk to people like us, and how could we make a setting like this both exciting for you to come back and safe enough to be who you are and share your views? I guess those are the questions.
You've already done that. You hear me okay?
Yeah, you're coming in great.
So as I've been listening to all of this, my mind has been just coming up with the millions of ideas. One thing I want to say right off the bat is that I think you are dead on the right track with having personal conversations person to person. I think that cuts through a lot of the battle within the battle. And by that I mean, there are many different, there are battles going on at many levels. At one level is that in Congress, you have to have the majority in order to be able to set the agenda and make the rules. And so the elected officials we see speaking, I think, are always playing that game. Okay, even though they might be, we might be hearing from them about any particular issue, it doesn't matter what the issue is, there's still that chess game happening behind the scenes about, I need to make sure my side has the majority in the House or the Senate, and they're playing that. And I think by having a conversation like this one, where it's just people talking to each other, that whole aspect disappears. Mm-hmm. And now it's just people talking to each other and expressing their feelings. And has Scott told you about Village Square? Mm-mm. That's another group kind of like this one. And it's run by Liz Joyner. She works out of Tallahassee, Florida. There are a few chapters around the country, but they too are making an effort to get people together and just talk to each other one-on-one. And I think that's a great, great way to break the ice and to get over the I don't know, walls or roadblocks that we put up with each between each other when we start talking about politics. So I thought you might come back to me. So I wrote some notes on some things that I might want to say. But that was the most important one. You've already done the things you need to do, if that's your question, to keep me interested and want to come back. Just by this, having this thing in the first place, I think it's terrific. I'll go back, and Scott's probably sick of hearing me talk about this, but I'll go back to the book, The Righteous Mind, and specifically, what I want to tell you is the direction that Dr. Haidt gave to me when he asked me to review the manuscript of it before he wrote it. And what he said was, as you read, pay attention to your, what he calls a flash of effect, which anybody who's in the psychology here knows what that is. It's that visible reaction. It's that gut feeling of like or dislike that we get when we see things around us in the social world. He said, be attentive to that. And whenever you experience one of those, tell me about it. Because some of those I'm trying to elicit in my writing. But others that happen by accident when I'm not trying to do it, I want to avoid. Basically, he's telling me, because he's liberal, he grew up liberal. He even admits in the book, Reagan-hating liberal household. He wants to be aware of where are the landmines that I'm stepping on inadvertently without even knowing it. And so I've heard three of those in this conversation. And I want to just say this as a way to help the dialogue so that you're aware and not as criticism. Because, you know, if I were a parent looking at my kid's paper who just came home with an exam with a 98 out of 100. What I want to do now is pick on the other 2%. Okay. So don't take this as it's like some sort of major criticism. And these are like catchphrases. These are like just terms that send up a flag and send up that negative reaction to me, which may or may not be appropriate to the way the term was actually meant. Okay, so one of those terms that I heard here is hate radio. As a conservative, just to give you perspective, if I want to hear hate radio, all I have to do is put on Rachel Maddow. Okay? Or basically MSNBC. The point there is hate is in the eye of the beholder. And some of the things I heard here are, now, another one I heard was psychologically deranged. And that came from Larry, who otherwise was probably my favorite of all the folks here so far. That too, I think, is in the eye of the beholder. I have had similar sentiments about people like, for example, Barack Obama. But from a different perspective, some of you may be aware of, or you're familiar with the Harry Potter movies. And one particular character, the Professor Umbridge, who was always dressed in pink, and she was very sweet and very likable and very gentle and very nice and very evil. There are different kinds of psychological derangement, so to speak. That's kind of an extreme phrase, and but I'm just using it here. I don't mean to say that somebody is or isn't psychologically deranged. I just use it here as an indicator of, as an example of a landmine that you step in without maybe even knowing it, and then turn off the very person who you want to be listening to you, even as you listen to them. Another one of those phrases is authoritarian. In, from my personal perspective, there is no greater authoritarian ideology than liberalism. One of the phrases I heard here, or one of the expressions I heard here, was one of the ideas I heard here was this idea of smug condescension, this sort of holier than thou self-righteousness that just sort of oozes out of liberalism from where I sit. I mean, if I asked you to come up with an example of that, I bet you could. You know, cling to their guns and religion and deplorables. I mean, there's just sort of this "we get it and they don't" sort of sentiment that leaks out. I like your, so again, all of these things are the 2% that you got wrong on the test, so to speak. But overall, I think this whole group and 98% of what I've heard here is the wonderful stuff. And I'm just trying to help you be a little sensitive to some of the landmines that you might be able to avoid, and in that way bring people into the conversation more than just sort of turn them off.
That's really,
I mean, I could probably talk for another hour if you wanted to let me, but that's the main thing that I summarize from what I've heard so far. I really like your deep dive, your desire to deep dive into about things, because there are a lot of us here. We each have a couple of minutes to talk. There's little opportunity to deep dive down into any one particular thing. So anyway, that's my first set of thoughts.
It's great, Stephen. If anyone wants to talk, just wave your hand. I'll call on you. Yes, James.
I've been thinking about the deep dive thing, and Stephen, I really appreciate your feedback. It's great. But I wonder if we do this again, if it might be worthwhile for people to sort of make a commitment in advance and maybe pick some questions or statements with which we would agree were the top priority to explore together. I really liked what we've done today and I liked what we did last time, but this sort of sequential, this is me and this is what I'm doing, I think we should move on from that at some point. At least for me, it would be value. I mean, we could pick something from this discussion that a lot of us are interested in. I think Scott's thing about you got to listen, don't expect equality, is interesting. You know, what's the transformative potential of deep listening is a question. What's the good of reason and policy when much of what politics is about the more primitive brain? I think Jonathan Haidt and other people have made that pretty clear. Who's doing the best thinking about the real value of cognitive diversity? I mean, those are just a few ideas that I have that might be fun to go into some depth. And maybe you could even have other, you know, if half of us are interested in one and half are in another, you do that one next week with those people. I'm not all that worried about getting conservatives into this conversation, although I very much enjoyed our efforts and I have some ideas of friends who might do that, but I think there's plenty of differences about values and priorities, even among my liberal friends. You know, get Sanders and Hillary supporters together, but in a productive way. Anyway, that's what I had to say.
Thanks. Yes, Cynthia.
I've been taking notes too, and let me run through them really quickly. One is that I think that resistance and dialogue don't have to be mutually exclusive. I think you can do both. Maybe not in the same minute, maybe not in the same hour, but I think you can do both. So you can talk to people and you can work against them at the same time in a jovial, friendly mood. You know, I think it's like a sports team. You know, you have your game, you say good game, and you have a drink after. You know, it's like you can get along with people and disagree with them. And if we can't do that, we're doomed because that's life, right? Okay, second thing was people kept saying we need to have more conservatives. One thing I've been learning is that Trump supporters and conservatives are not the same thing. There are a lot of conservatives who don't like Trump. There are some who do. And it's gotten a lot more confusing than just saying people on the right. So I think there's a sort of multidimensionality to what's going on lately that has to be taken into account. Should I keep going? Okay. Third, somebody mentioned marriage counseling, which I thought was a great metaphor. And it made me think of this guy, John Gottman, his work on marriage, which, you know, if you've been married for 25 years, you've probably read it by now. And he has this great book, and he says, there's two tidbits from it that I think are really important to this. One is that he has this thing he calls the four horsemen of the apocalypse related to marriage, and I just looked them up so I could say them. They're criticism, defensiveness, contempt, and stonewalling. And boy, can we see a lot of that in the last 2 months, huh? So it would be interesting to think about each one of those things and how each one of those things could be counter, you know, worked against. And another thing that he says that I find really useful in my own life is he talks about repair movements. I think that's the right word. Repair something where like two people are arguing and one person will be like, oh, let me pick up your dish and put it in the dishwasher. And that's called a repair movement because they're just like taking this tiny step forward. And I think a lot of people are doing that lately. And part of what he says people need to do to get along is recognize those repair movements and respond to them. So, you know, like I'm having a thing where I had a disagreement with a neighbor about politics, about him putting a Trump sign on my driveway. It's a shared driveway, but he didn't ask me. But anyway, the point is that he's been making repair movements lately and I've been making them. And it's like, if we think about that societally, we can think about how that fits into everything. My next thing is somebody was saying about how, you know, is it all going to work anymore? Is democracy going to fall apart? And I just want to share something that the other day I was talking to a guy at Oxfam who he was talking to me about a proposal I was going to put in for a project they were doing. And it was going to be in Burundi. And he said, I said, well, and what I do is I help people collect stories and work with stories. And I said, it'd be really great if you could get like 5 people together to share their stories with each other. And he said, oh, I don't think we can do that. The government won't allow us to bring 5 people together. So we have to kind of realize that it's not so bad here yet. I mean, it could get bad. It could get worse. But, you know, I think we have to keep things in perspective that, you know, yes, this is maybe a sort of a crisis, but it's not as bad as that. And we can, you know, there's a lot we can still do. The thing about deep dives that we can't get deep enough, I feel like we should just be grateful for anything we can get. Deeper is better, right? And then my last thing is that when Stephen was talking about the language people use in the landmines, that of course I have to put in a plug for the Red Blue Dictionary, which is the project I've been working on for the last year, and we're getting deeply into that. And in fact, I wrote the entry on authoritarianism, and we had a little bit of a discussion where I wanted to say that the liberals were authoritarian, and some people didn't like that, but it got in there. So that is an interesting, if you want to look up the Red Blue Dictionary, that's a project where we're actually actively working on representing all views of what these different terms mean. So I'm done.
Cynthia, just for clarification, I'll put it on the shared notes here. Is that Red Blue Dictionary, is it online? Can we actually have access to it yet, or how do we find it?
Yes, it's actually also called the All Sides Dictionary. So if you go to allsides.com, I can type that in the thing. I'll put it after. Oh, you're putting it.
I am.
Allsides.com. Yeah. And then just click on dictionary right there at the top. That leads you to the whole thing.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah.
Very cool.
I'll just mute again here.
Stephen.
Okay, a couple of things that I want to say that I liked. Somebody's sharing a screen all of a sudden.
Yeah, did somebody mean to share a screen? Somebody's sharing a screen. Jim.
It's me. I was just trying to get to the notes, and I'm having trouble doing that. I'm sorry about that.
So you just need to stop sharing your screen. Let's see. Which
is done. Got some really nice dental work. Really nice.
To get out of it, go down to the very bottom of your screen and you'll see a share screen. Just click on that button, James. Down to the bottom of your Zoom screen. And you'll see where it says mute, stop video. If you just go along that bottom, you'll see something that says share screen and you just need to click on it. Very bottom. Take your cursor down to the bottom. Keep going. Down, 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 down. Keep going. Down to the very bottom of your Zoom. There you are. You almost got to it. when you take your cursor all the way down to the bottom, do you see there's a bunch of things that come up?
Maybe he has to find his Zoom window.
Yeah, perhaps. There's a bar on top that says mute, stop video, participants.
No, you don't want to do that. You know what?
Stop share.
There you go.
It was up on the top. Okay, sorry about that.
Okay, no worries.
I will mute myself.
Okay, Stephen, you're on.
Okay, about multidimensionality, I think you're right there. I think we have a new thing going on here that doesn't fit the usual stereotypical left-right dynamic. And I have found 2 articles that I think nail it. And so what I'll do is, I don't know, provide a link, I guess, to those in the chat. But I think if in reading those, you will see that multidimensionality you're talking about. There's sort of a new dynamic happening here that I think a lot of people have missed. So I'll add those. One of the favorite things that I've heard here is the idea that everybody, bar none, is doing what they think is the right thing. Their heart is in the right place in their own way of seeing things. And they think they really are doing what's best for themselves and for society and for the country. So I think for me personally, it's helpful to come in with that assumption. And when I hear something from somebody who I disagree with, how try to put myself in that mode and say, well, if I am coming at this with the best of intentions and really wanting the best society for all people in it, and I said that, how could I have meant that? So that's a couple of things that that I've heard that I liked.
Larry, you're on mute.
Yeah, there we go. Yeah, I building on that, I my age and my memory goes. I was going to build on what you said, Stephen. I whenever somebody says something that flags me, and I get flagged like you do many times, I ask myself, what world is there, what is their world that justifies or accounts for that action? And I want to qualify in the sense that, yeah, that was not the right term to use for Donald Trump. I like Donald Trump. We have enough recordings of him and his history that one can objectively study. And I don't feel I think he really believes he is the only person on the planet. And there are kinds of psychological cases that people do this. And if one would be able to take an objectively look at his performance, and I feel, and I see nobody talking about it, his children are absolutely essential for his stability. That is why he has them. He couldn't function without them. And therefore he has to have, that's a hypothesis. But I think that to have a person independent of his positions as the ideology and morality, to have a person of that psychological nature at the position of POTUS in the United States is very, very dangerous. And I think that one should look to that independent of the, I mean, there are other kinds of people who could become president, and we suddenly realize, no, we've discovered something about them, and they would not, we can't trust that to happen. And I think that's the case for Donald Trump.
Well, it does raise a question, not that you have to be the only one, Steve, where that question's directed, but it does raise a question that I've been having around, are there parts in the conservative political arena, I guess, that do have concerns about Trump? And if so, like, where are, if you could, like, give us some insight, like, how are people now sort of adjusting to the fact that he really is going to be our president?
Were you asking me, or?
I was actually directing it at Stephen, if Steve would.
Yeah, I had to get off mute there. Okay, so one thing I want to say is that I'm only speaking for me.
Oh, I know. I wish you were speaking for everybody, but.
Yeah, and I have some criticisms of conservatives or conservatism myself. To answer your question about what are the conservative objections to Donald Trump, the best thing I can do is direct you toward the magazine National Review or the Weekly Standard, because they both had a lot of articles written by some of their big name
thinkers that outlined their own objections or criticisms or whatever you might want to call it to Trump and his positions. And I wouldn't want to pretend to try to speak on their behalf. But one of the things that I see happening, I think, gets back to this idea of multidimensionality. I think that people are, even conservatives or conservatism are, well, I guess the way I would say it is that old saying about two eyes, two ears, one mouth, use them in proportion. There's more concern with telling everybody else what your perspective is and trying to, I guess, you almost might say virtue signaling for conservatism than actually trying to understand what is really happening out there on the ground. And that's why I refer to these two articles. I put them on the link on the chat. I don't know if you see them.
Yes.
But I did them in reverse order. The first one about the revenge of the forgotten class is very good. And then the other one about return of street corner conservatism, I think, is also very good. I think even conservatives are missing a little bit about what's going on. They're so concerned with framing their own position and defending their own ideology as they see it, that even they aren't really, really listening to what's happening on the ground. And so I'd recommend, my own view is to read those two articles that I linked to get what I think was even they are missing.
Thank you, that's great. I'm so aware how I have so many questions and how little I spend personally reading conservative journals like the National Review and the Weekly Standard. So it does make me now feel much more curious that you've mentioned these. I feel like, yeah, for me to, that would be a good first step. Because I think, Larry, you're right, we do live in our bubbles. And of course, then, if we live in our bubbles, we're not even seeing the other perspective. And I don't mean from, you know, an MSNBC or Fox News point of view, which we, I think we can all say, both probably, you know, show the meanest perspectives of both the parties. So perhaps by actually reading, you know, progressive and conservative, more well-thought literature, we can inform ourselves before we even get to a dialogue. So thank you for bringing that up, Steve.
Can I say something about the bubble? First of all, I do subscribe to New Republic also. Just want to put that out there. So I think a lot of what's happening is not a left thing or a right thing, but it's really just a human thing. And I think sometimes we see that human thing in the other side and attribute it to the other side when that's really not what it is. It's really just our tribalism. I've mentioned Haidt, and a couple other people have here too, so I assume there's some level of familiarity with that, with him. And one of the things that he points out is that tribalism. Humans evolve to form into groups of like-minded people, which then do battle with other groups for, you know, political power and scarce resources. And our first allegiance is usually to the group. And when we feel that the group is threatened, the first thing that gets thrown under the bus is truth or reason and rational thought. And that kind of stuff is a human thing that everybody does. An example that's happening right now is one that's come up here a bit, is this idea of resistance from the left. The left spent 8 years of the Obama presidency talking about how the right is the party of no and the party of obstructionism and, you know, on and on and on. And yet when Trump was elected, what's the very first thing they do? The exact same thing. So I don't mean to say that as a criticism of the left. I mean to say that as an example of the kinds of things that are human things that everybody does, that we are too quick to paste the other side with as a flaw. I think that the number of things that really are different between left and right is very small, but their influence is quite profound. And part of what I think conversations like this might be able to do is tease out what might those actual differences be, because even just being aware of them, you can still disagree, you can still hate it, but just being aware that it's there, I think, is a fantastic step beyond where many people are right now.
Yes. Deb.
Oh, yay. Am I on?
You're on.
Okay, yay. So I took some notes, and I want to tell you a couple of things that I've done going door to door, because personally, I think all issues are nonpartisan. Who wants better education for their kids, Republicans or Democrats? All parents do. Who wants best water to drink? We all do, or we die in 3 days. So I personally think all issues are nonpartisan. I think the parties take something and make them partisan, use divisive points, but all issues, I believe, are totally nonpartisan in and of themselves. So I've been door-to-door on a number of surveys that I've personally dreamt up, and two of them, the most recent one, has been going door-to-door in an area in Tacoma where I live. It's basically suddenly I'm nervous. It's basically middle-income, middle-America, and so nothing big, nothing dramatic, some diversity, not a lot. So 100 Tacomans, I asked them, what are your concerns? Point, just open-ended, what are your concerns? So I've tabulated everything, and out of 330 comments, there were 113 unique concerns. Somebody else might calculate them differently, but that's what I did. So I personally think that if I spent more time with everybody, we could come up with a heck of a lot more, but that's how much people wanted to give me in the 5 minutes that I was at the doorstep or in between their cooking meals or whatever it was. So I tabulated all of those, and I'm actually now going through the minutes and the strategic plans of the bodies that govern them to see if any of their issues have been addressed in the last year. And I'm finding that fascinating. So speaking of transparency, we don't have much transparency in, at least in the minutes. So I wanted to say that in addition to there were some partisan innuendos this time around, but not much. And I did this also a couple of years ago for only like 8 hours. And in 12 homes on that day, there were some people that were distinctly partisan. Oh, just dripping on both sides. But my question again was, what are your concerns? And so when they put partisan stuff to me, that felt like it was just bickering rather than addressing it, saying this is my concern. I'd ask them or push more for what is something that's right actionable on this. If it's not actionable, then I'm sorry you don't like so-and-so or those lousy whatevers, but that's not an actionable item. So I found it interesting when I kind of pushed back a little bit that people just, you know, they were high in their partisanship. When I pushed back a little bit, like, oh yeah, well, okay, well, now that you mentioned I'm concerned about transportation, and they're much more calm. So I think if we are focusing on the partisan divide, begin to get it. If you're just focusing on concerns, that's a whole different subject. And I'd be interested to hear if Ms. Shapiro's had the same experience in what she did. So, so one side comment is I found it very comical to hear that somebody was very upset about Trump being authoritarian or whatnot. Thinking, isn't that just the role of the president? Don't they get to do that? So getting back to what Stephen said, we have to be a little bit more clear. I forgot the words that you said, but a little bit more clear on what we're really, really talking about. So other, I could just mention a couple of other surveys, and you may have read this on the listserv already, I'm not sure. So about 2 years ago, I went door to door in three different communities, one a very wealthy, the wealthiest zip code in Washington state, and a middle area in Tacoma that I thought was diverse, but it wasn't. So then I sought out diversity. And I don't know if anybody knows, the Rainier Beach area in Seattle is very diverse, one of the two most diverse areas in Washington state. And then that's when I decided I don't want to discriminate against the wealthy, so I went to Medina. So I asked everybody if any of their elected officials had asked them their concerns. Everybody, that was over 300 people, over 300 people said that none of their elected officials had asked them their concerns. So I think when we're spending all this time worrying about the partisan divide here or there, or that party versus my party, I think we're wasting time in actually addressing concerns and issues. And there are a heck of a lot of them out there. Granted, I think we all kind of share maybe the same top 100. It's just that my three are going to be a top priority for me this year, and I may never ever hear your top bottom, or maybe your bottom three, which we'll never get to because your top three might, did I say that right? I think you know what I mean. So to the extent that we're spending time on this stuff, we're not addressing issues, and there are people in Tacoma who had lots of concerns. Some were big, some were small. So I just think, I forgot what I was going to summarize with, but basically I would just like to see that our concerns are addressed, because there are a lot of people, and even just in what we're doing today, where's diversity? I'm not sure that we have a lot of diversity of thought, although I think you get two people together, you're going to have a lot of diversity of thought. But where are the people who are never invited? One other short, quick story. I ran for school board because I wanted to close the education opportunity gap in my local Tacoma school district. I already came in stinking last out of six people, so I lost. But playing the game of candidate, I knocked on people's doors who vote 3 out of 4 times. I'd say most everybody here today is one of those frequent voters. And so as I was doing this, I noticed that people were all those frequent voters 3 out of 4 times. They tended to be white, so they don't have kids in the education opportunity gap. I should define that in case nobody knows. Kids of color are not achieving at the same rates as whites in Washington, and if we close that gap, it will take 54 years at the rate we've been going as of 2010. So as I knocked on people's doors who voted 3 out of 4 times, those people were white, no kids of color in their family. They were higher income, that didn't help. And they were over 65 years old. I think I'm being generous, about 65 years old. So as a candidate for school board, if we want to have all our kids of color graduating, when was I ever going to speak to families of color? I went to those areas and followed my list of people who vote 3 out of 4 times, because they're more likely to vote for you if you ask them to. And as a candidate, I want to get in. So when I went to those areas, I was skipping whole blocks because hardly anybody of color was registered to vote. So that's another one of my big pushes, is enough of us white folk who are privileged, or so we think, what about other people? So while I'm grateful for all the conversations that are happening, I think what happens is we invite our friends or people we know, not necessarily willing to go out to another area that we are stinking scared to go in those areas, and ask them what their concerns are. And I find it fascinating. So I did a charter. I was a signature gatherer for charter schools in Washington state, the best charter school law. And I found it fascinating. So it was going to help struggling. The charter schools in Washington are only supposed to go to struggling areas, and we're only allowing 8 a year, up to 40 to come in. So that's not very much. That's a drop in the bucket for the whole education population in Washington state. So what I found fascinating gathering those signatures is that white families who had already taken their kids out of the public school system in rich areas said, give me that charter, give me that initiative to sign, because I know what it was like in my family, but I know other families can't afford it. So I find it fascinating there aren't really other opportunities to link with families that might be in more struggle. And when are elected officials, school board members, or school board candidates, or state legislators ever going to ask families of color what, or other people disenfranchised, or all of us technically, what their concerns are? And that's the rest of my story, and I think I'm done. Thank you.
Thanks, Deb. It's quite a story where you're just going off by yourself getting this, where really our elected officials should be doing it. So you're kind of filling in the gap. Who hasn't spoken that would like to jump in? We're getting close to the hour and I want to do a little takeaway round. But if there's someone that has something they'd like to get in who hasn't spoken much.
I just wanted to respond a little bit to Deb here. She has said several times that I think, I mean, Deb, correct me if I'm get this wrong, but you're saying that the problem really isn't partisanship. It's about making sure that we talk the issues and that we're listening to one another about issues, about specific problems like transportation or whatever. Is that right?
So I'm not sure transportation, am I on?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm not sure transportation is a partisan issue, but it could be. I think what I'm saying is instead of being concerned about what the political divides are, just addressing the issues, identifying root causes and solutions.
Okay. Yeah. And this is what I want to address, Deb. I'm uncomfortable with the dichotomy that you're making. I think that what you're talking about is a really great, it's something I do a lot. I mean, when I'm talking with conservatives, I really like to focus on issues and actual situations because the closer you get to the ground, you know, I mean, my standard picture is the notion of a traffic light downtown. You know, that there may be sort of partisan issues there, but there's not very many, you know, and there's other considerations that aren't really partisan. But partisanship is important, in my opinion, to think about because for a couple of different reasons. One is that we have very specific psychological differences. We have really clear personality differences. And so that really weighs in a lot when we converse. And secondly, one of the reasons why partisanship matters is that partisanship is the way that we actually arrange the things that we believe, the specific things about, say, transportation or, you know, freedom and all these other things. And so there's a very deep sort of cultural component to it. And when we say, well, all that really matters is the issues, we're at risk to ignore these very strong, very big cultural components where we sort of clump together and we have ideas together. We're not really very independent creatures. And so that's a lot of my own work is trying to understand the sort of social component to it. And then this other piece that I think is really an educational thing. It's like, don't go to conservatives as a liberal and treat them as if they're liberals. You know, understand that you have a statistical likelihood of personality differences and address those really in your mind so that you're actually talking to that person a little bit differently, or at least being open to doing that. You know, so that's just a couple of things I want to add to the notion that you said of really focusing on issues. How was it?
Thanks, Scott.
I didn't get that last one.
I'm sorry, Deb, can you say that again?
I couldn't hear his last part. It was kind of muffled. I'm not sure if it was my phone or something.
Sorry.
Yeah, there's a little bit of instability in your setup. So we.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay. It happens. Does anyone else have anything pressing? Otherwise, I'd love to do a round. It's time to do it anyways. You can speak then. So let's just do a takeaway round. What would you like to take away from this conversation? And any thoughts for what we might do next time around? I know Jim has already mentioned something. Do you like to be called Jim or James?
Jim.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, so I guess I will... Let's start with you, Cynthia, if that's all right.
Sure. I really like the idea, and I don't know who said it, of basically starting out and then splitting up and picking like a topic and having only maybe three or four people on per, what do they call them, rooms, breakout rooms, whatever, and then come back together and report. Because when you don't have to wait for 12 other people to talk, sometimes you can cycle around a little faster. Mm-hmm. So I think that's an interesting idea.
Okay. Anything you'll take away from this particular dialogue?
No, a lot of things. I think one thing that I could say is that I'm not liberal or conservative. I'm somehow some complicated mixture. So, I mean, I was raised as a knee-jerk conservative, and then I switched to being a knee-jerk liberal, and then that all fell apart, and now I don't know what I am. So I think what somebody said, if you get two people together, you have a lot of diversity of thought. My experience is if you get one person together, you have a lot of diversity of thought. And I think finding the diversity in our own thought is actually a good way to break down some of the tribalism.
That's an interesting idea. Okay. Thank you. All right. Stephen, if you'd be willing to go next. Any takeaways, and what would you suggest if we do this again?
I have to ponder what a suggestion might be for what to do again. I think Deb is right in the sense that issues are nonpartisan, but I also think that Scott is right that the partisanship appears when you start digging into what the solutions to the issues might actually be. And I don't know how to approach it, but you know, if for example we picked one issue like climate change, I'm not sure that would be fruitful. I think what I personally would want to explore is to try to tease out what actually really are the differences, the bottom line core differences between left and right that cause those different ideas on what the solutions might be. One other thing I'd want to throw in there is talking about the things that aren't really left things or right things, but are really human things. The bubble itself is one of those. This country has been an official country for 230 something years and existed, you know, for long before that. And I think there's been ample time for us to start self-segregating into those, who here, or I'll just say it, the book Coming Apart by Murray, I think it is. Who wrote Coming Apart? Daniel, Charles Murray. Right, it's Charles. The book Coming Apart, the topic is the bubble, and specifically how we tend to gravitate into geographic areas where everyone else in that area thinks like we do. And he does surveys, he finds out what people in the different regions within the countries think. And recently there was an article, in PBS and elsewhere, where he said, if you want your children to grow up clueless about what it's like to live in basically the flyover states, right? Flyover country, where would you want them to live? And based on survey questions that he, had hundreds and thousands of people answer, he made a map of the United States that shows, it looks kind of like a map of the country if it had been taken at night. You know, it's an outline, it's very dark with light spots where these bubbles areas are, where people are the most clueless about what it's like to live in the rest of the country. Now that map, if you put it next to the map of the counties that Hillary won, they're the same map.
Interesting.
So now I And again, I'm saying that to point out that this bubble itself is sort of the thing that we're up against. I'm not pointing out to say that liberals are wrong or don't get. I'm just saying it's part of human nature that we're sort of naturally working against in order for us to try to understand each other. It's like a built-in roadblock that almost guarantees we're not going to hear each other.
Yeah. Thank you. That was great. Courtney, takeaways and any suggestions for next time?
I have notes and things that I'm going to reflect on some more in the time between calls. And I appreciate, you know, some of the conversation we've been able to have today, about, you know, partisanship and different viewpoints and, the realities of some of that. I think that's been really, really helpful and really useful. And it'll be helpful to me as I continue to think about this, because it's something that it's occupying a lot of my brain right now. I like the idea, for next time of doing some breakouts and being able to dig in a little deeper, with folks, especially if we continue to have a larger group like this, which is fabulous. Maybe we do a little bit of small group and then we come back together. I think that could be exciting, and might get at some particular interest areas for several of us, because it sounds like there's a little bit of diversity in what we all want to be talking about. And perhaps we can both have space to talk about that and then also share with one another what we've gathered from those conversations. So I think that would be a neat next step for next call.
Awesome. Thank you. All right. Jim.
I appreciate the interest in the breakout idea, although even more important to that to me would be to have some discussion ahead of time about what are the three things that we'd most like to explore with our time, and maybe think about that ahead of time. Maybe I'm more of an introvert and like to think ahead. I don't know. But for example, Stephen's idea about focusing on climate change and going deeper with that could be really interesting. The other question I had, I don't know, are people making themselves available for individual contact that are on this, or could they have a choice to do that? I have some questions for, was it David Fridley, about what you're doing, and I'm curious about what Stephen is doing and Scott Wagner, you know, just various people that I have questions that I might want to send them a note. I don't know if that's, you can always ignore me if you don't want to do that, but.
Well, two things.
That'd be useful.
Two things, Jim, you can do it. If anyone wants to stay after a little while, I can show you some things on Kiko Chat that you can do that would facilitate that. The other thing you can do, of course, is I'll send out an email message to all of us that have been on this call, so you'll all have each other's email lists, email addresses.
And the only other thing I wanted to say was just how much I appreciated Steve and your thoughtful, you know, it's hard to speak for groups. You're obviously a very sharp guy, very thoughtful guy, and it's been great for me to hear your point of view.
Thanks, Jim. Larry, any checkout ahas that you want to share?
Oh, God, I got caught up by, I'm making a note again on terms of Stephen's report on that coordination of the Hillary supporters. I'm not a Hillary supporter. I consider a war criminal or what she did in Libya, and I feared that if she was president, she might declare war on Russia. But on the other hand, to say that Hillary's bubbles were bigger than the Republican bubble, I think is bubble. So I'll let it go with that.
All right, Larry, thanks. Lloyd, would you like to follow?
Mute.
You're on mute, Lloyd. You're all on mute.
Okay. Sorry.
just let Stephen know that I really appreciate your involvement tonight, and that when I talked about Hey Radio, and I understand your point completely, it's not something I would use in standard conversation with people, and I shouldn't have tonight, but I do include left radio and hate radio as well. Anything that comes from a standpoint of we're right and everybody else is wrong, that's my definition of hate radio. And I really enjoyed the concerns of people tonight. One thing I'd say is that I find most helpful to have the attitude of what can we learn together, what can we learn from each other, rather than approaching this as a way to solve problems. I don't find that approach helpful. And some things I'd love to discuss in greater depth. I'm a great student of nonviolence. And so I opposed resistance because it doesn't work. And I would love to discuss that further with anybody who wants to. And also, we tend to romanticize the value of rational thought. And my understanding from reading Bohm is that where his interest in dialogue came from was at least linked to his recognition of the limitations of our thoughts, the way that we think, which is self-reflexive and self-reinforcing. And that's what I see happening in all of our political dialogue.
Yeah, it's hard to do a pure Bohm dialogue until we've had a chance to really get to know each other, because it's all about our thinking process, and we can't go deep until we know enough of the surface of our thinking process. But if this group stays together, I think eventually we can move in that direction. I know I would certainly like to do that. Okay, Nancy, and I'm sorry, can you all stay for just a few more minutes? I realize we're at the top of the hour, but I'd like to at least finish up with our go-around. If you have to drop off, I totally understand. Nancy, go ahead. Nancy, you're on mute.
Really, really appreciate the insight of your comments and clarity of them, and open-heartedness of them. And it's been a while since I've been in a conversation I found as meaningful as the one I was in today. I'm feeling really grateful for it. And when you said, Stephen, that you could talk an hour, I almost said, yeah, do. I could listen for an hour. And I would like us to build in maybe a way that if we do stay together, that we could give different people a chance to go more in depth while we're all together, as well as liking the idea of us also having the chance to break into small groups. And I think tracking the questions that have been raised, going back over them and kind of sorting them out, and then, as someone suggested, maybe focusing, picking up on some of those questions and making one or two of those the focus of a particular conversation also sounds very promising to me. So thanks so much, all of you. Great group.
Thanks, Nancy. Scott, would you like to go next?
Just very briefly, thank you very much. I'm going to stay on for another 25 minutes or so for anybody that wants to keep talking about anything. Lloyd, nonviolence is interesting. I know, James, you had some issues you wanted to talk about. Steve, if you have time, that'd be great if you could stay on too, but whatever. Anyway, thanks, everybody. I learned a few things. It's great.
Thank you, Scott, so much. And thank you for inviting Stephen. Deb, would you like to go next?
I tend to have my best thoughts after I've slept on something, so I don't know what a takeaway is or what to do next. Sorry. But I will say, in the partisan discussions, are we leaving out the biggest population is independents, 42% of the population per both Pew and Gallup research. Just wanted to say that.
Thank you. Well, that's certainly so, for sure. David, would you like to check out any takeaways, anything you'd like to share possibly for next time? David Sachs. Yeah, you're still on mute. Uh-oh, there you are.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. Right. I really appreciate this conversation. It's spoken so much to what I am trying to be doing in my life here at least several hours per week, and how to infuse my my teaching and my involvement in my community, and expanding from my bubble in what I read, in who I interact with. Very, very important. The importance of dialogue within people who are in my bubble, accessing the diversity around resistance, around dialogue, around rational thought versus feeling. Lots of things for me to work on, which I really appreciate everyone's participation and really hope we continue.
All
thank
right.
you.
Thank you, David.
And I'm going to have to go.
All right. We'll see you next time. And the last but not least, David Friedley.
Hi. Well, I really appreciated this and I guess getting more diversity. I actually, one of my takeaways is talking about people's concerns, Deb, that I even maybe a better way of talking about it, about, you know, what are the issues, which are these big broad things that maybe don't relate to people so specifically, you know, asking people, well, what are your concerns? I think is an important way to start. Anyways, that's one of my takeaways, as well as I have already pulled up the two links that Stephen, you sent out, and I'm going to read those and probably check out more from those sites. So I guess that's my takeaways. And I put my email up for anybody who wants to talk. You know, I'm all for that, and you know, I'm working on this website that I could show you. So that's all.
Thank you, David. So I think my takeaway is that this was a really rich conversation. We never have enough time to explore everything, and there's a lot to explore. This is a hugely complex topic we've bitten off, but we chipped away with it, and I really appreciate so much, Stephen, your participation, and Courtney, if we can, attract more conservative people, that would be great. Don't really know how to do it. If those of you who'd like to stay on a little bit, I'd love to come up with a process perhaps for next time, whether we want to come up with certain topics that we're interested in. I mean, we could almost pick any one. What are some of the topics that people would like to go deep on? I guess I'm kind of curious. And if you want to jump off, that's fine. What I will promise to do for next week or next time is to put out an e-list to everyone that's been on either the first one or this one. And I think what I'll do is I'll ask for topics. We'll see what I get back. And just, you know, keep everybody informed. That way we'll have each other's emails in that list. So if you want to contact each other, you can do that. And I'm also happy to spend a few minutes going over how to get on to Kiko Chat if anyone wants to do that. So
I'd like to say that I have to go.
Okay.
And I think a topic of the bubble would be a really great topic to talk about.
Can you phrase that in a question? How would you phrase it?
I don't know. What should we do about the bubble? Everybody's got one. How do we work with that? We can't get rid of them.
Right.
So
without living in a bubble. Okay.
I thought of a question.
And the thing is, to some extent, you can't survive without a bubble either. It's a survival mechanism. You can't just deal with everything every minute, every time. It's like the heuristics biases that we have. They're a survival mechanism. So they're good and bad mixed together. So is the bubble. So, you know, how do we live the best we can given that?
And by bubble, you're also referring to the idea of tribal. You know, we're tribal people, right?
Yes. Yes. Right.
Yeah. Okay. That's good. Thank you.
But I have to go. So.
All right.
Thanks, everybody.
Cynthia, so good to see you.
Thank you.
So any other idea about topics?
I thought of one that I want to kind of throw out there. I can do it two ways, on a personal level as just me, or on a more abstract level as a conservative versus liberal. If I'm conservative and you are liberal, what is it about you that I don't understand? What, or said differently, what stereotype do you see that conservatives have about liberals that is wrong? Or what things do conservatives say typically about liberals that most sets off your desire to go punch them in the nose? You know, I talked about landmines before. Well, what are the ones that I miss when I talk? That's kind of the idea. It's like four different ways to phrase the same basic thought that I had. And the other side of that is I can give my take on the opposite side of that coin.
Okay, so what I'm hearing is one question, if we had a better mix of people who were more conservative, we might talk about stereotypes just in general, what conservatives feel that liberals don't understand about them, and then vice versa, something like that?
Something like that, yeah. So you want a dialogue, you want to have an exchange of ideas, and the topic today or the main subject was the divide. Mm-hmm. So let's talk about the divide. Mm-hmm. Let's, instead of getting into climate change or abortion or taxes or taxing the rich or any of those kind of typical issues, let's talk about the divide itself. What is it that I don't understand about liberals that I need to understand? What things do I say that set you off, that make you want to just say, well, this guy doesn't get it? And then, you know, let me say the same thing the other way. Let's put those landmines out in the open so we have less of a chance of stepping on them.
I like it. Jim.
Stephen, I appreciate that. I'm wondering if we framed it in terms of needs and values, could we get there in a different way? I understand the flashbulb landmine metaphor, but it seems to me from the reading I'm doing, and I grew up in a very conservative part of the country in the 50s and 60s before the counterculture got there. So I actually have a lot of sympathy with the right conservative point of view. I've read Charles Murray. I actually have a fair amount of respect for him. But I wonder, when I talk to my friends, and I'm trying to think of somebody I could invite next time, mm-hmm. who's a retired banker in Chicago, voted for Trump proudly. We had long conversations. I think I talked about him in the last meeting. And he might be willing to join. He reminds me of you. He's a very thoughtful guy. He's a Phi Beta Kappa from Marquette. We're close friends. We share all sorts of things, and we're just very far apart politically. But I find when I talk to him, we have good, productive conversations around what we value and what we need. And when we come across different language and different ideologies, we often go, well, what's the need behind the need? Mm-hmm. What's the value behind the value? Those people in Hothschild's book who are poisoning their children, it looks to me, in the petrochemical toxicity of southern Louisiana, they really need dignity. They need masculinity. They need to take care of their families. There are some very universal needs behind what look to me like pretty self-destructive behaviors politically, voting to cut the public schools and all that stuff. So I'm just asking you, would needs and values be another way to kind of explore that?
I think, sure. Yeah, I'm not particularly wedded to the way I phrased it. I'm just kind of throwing something out there for fodder to talk about. One of the words that I picked up on that you just said is language. One of my things is that, and Scott's heard me say this many times, is that left or right, liberals and conservatives, use the same words, but the concept that I have in mind when I use a word can be very, very different from the one that somebody else has in mind when they use the exact same word.
Yes.
So we can agree that liberty is wonderful, equality is wonderful, justice, all these things, but then when we start talking about, well, how do we actually achieve those things, we end up thinking, wait, I thought you liked liberty. How can you say that? So we have different ideas in mind when we use the same words. So maybe language is a way to approach it too.
This is where, as we keep going deeper, this is where bone dialogue can get very, very useful, because we start to ask each other, what's your assumption around that word? You know, and we start to actually learn what it is we're talking about rather than just keeping at these big abstractions. So
yeah, part of my whole thesis or theme or approach is exactly that. Let's look at the assumptions that underlie these things that we just take for granted that maybe we shouldn't be.
Exactly.
I take a kind of a meta issue here, because I don't think there is a split. I don't think there's just two. I think there are multiple different perspectives. And it is the nature of the societal system, the media and other things, that forces us into the illusion that there's just two sides. And I think also, and this is a very important issue, and I think that hate concepts apply to it, is when we talk about tribal, but the human brain is only capable of handling in its consciousness a system of three or four variables at a time. And the realities of the societal systems have hundreds. Every human being, myself included, at any particular moment, I have to greatly warp what I am trying to understand into a few variables, and two sides is the easiest one there. It's not the reality as two sides, it's that that's what we apply to it. And I don't know where we got. I mean, to me, this is not something that is resolved in terms of dialogue or interactivity. It has to change over time through a reform of educational systems. And how we go about doing that is a much bigger issue. And I couldn't participate in a dialogue on the division when I don't see the division is real. It is in our heads at any one moment, but whether it's real out there, I don't know.
Nancy?
I didn't comment before how much, Deb, I appreciated your assertion again and again, which I really identified with, that the issues themselves are not partisan. And if we move into more of a problem-solving mode where we're working together and the problem's outside of us, together we're trying to solve it, and our diverse perspectives and diverse needs are actually strengths in terms of getting at a deeper understanding of all sides of the problem. I think partly the either or two-sidedness comes out of the fact that we have a two-party system, and that to the extent that we're electing offices that are partisan by definition, they're forced to be, there's a place for that, but I think we've allowed it to way, way, way too much dominate how we think about what the challenges are in coming together. I'm cautious about analyses of the other, in which I say they have a different mind than mine. I think that's a very slippery slope. I do think it's appropriate to say different people have different language and maybe different priorities, and we need to be sensitive to that. And a lot of the points that Stephen has been making about really being in touch with what way of talking to each other opens up communication and what ways shut it down. And that's true of any two people trying to talk to each other, especially around the issues that are sensitive. I would like us to get in to look closely, study closely the transpartisan movement. They've explored some of the territory we're trying to get into and are trying to build a, if you will, in a sense, a movement out of that, building on the fact that the research suggests we agree on 80% of the issues anyhow. It's the 10 to 20% that are used, that we're manipulated into dividing on when it comes right down to two people who might even be very close to each other politically. If they're running against each other for office, they're going to emphasize the divisions because it's an either or. That's the way our electoral system is set up. So those are just a few thoughts.
Nancy, can I ask a question? When you say you've been studying the transpartisan movement, do you have a source you're looking at? I mean, I know.
I don't have it in front of me right this second, but yes. In fact, at the NCDD conferences, we've had several very strong presentations by people involved. And my understanding, I haven't read it, but I think Ralph Nader's most recent book is on transpartisanship. So part of it, it's a matter of getting at the, it's another way of getting at the 1%, 99%, that most of us have an awful lot in common in terms of what the problems are that we need to address. And we get fooled into not focusing on those and letting people, as it were, get away with murder, because the good old divide and conquer, they get us fighting each other and, you know, and not really listening to each other. So with that larger context, I think there is both a space for the quality of in-depth connecting with each other as human beings. And I love the way you framed the questions, Deb, and the things that you've been doing. And at the same time, a rethinking of even, if you will, the partisan politics, so that we try to force the electoral process into something that more substantially addresses the real problems that we have, and to work together to achieve that rather than allowing ourselves to be divided. Those are my thoughts.
Could I add something to what Nancy said? Or
sure.
So as an example, my personal example of an issue we definitely have partisanship over is abortion. So I'm just going to touch on it. So I truly believe, as it is nonpartisan, and definitely if we, all of us can name the side, the left sides and the right side talking points. I truly believe abortion is also nonpartisan. I'm almost 60 years old and have never, I had nothing to do in 4 months. Gee, I think I'm going to get pregnant and then have an abortion. So what is the real cause, the root cause of abortions? No one's addressing that. I definitely have a side, whether it's left or right. I definitely have a side, but that doesn't address the root cause. Why do women have abortions? What are the contributing factors? That we have the opposing sides, I definitely support my side, but it still does not address the root cause. So I think that many issues are nonpartisan. Another piece about partisanship, there's a group called, openprimaries.org, I think is what they are, openprimaries.org. So most of the country, except for California and Washington, are required to vote in either their primary or their general election, or required to register to vote as a partisan person. So in many cases, when independents can't really vote, if you want to change to a different party, you have to re-register. So that automatically, like Nancy said, sets us up for our partisan divide. There isn't really another choice. If we get rid of partisan voting, maybe it's going to be slightly different, but the parties can still exist. I forgot who said that. I think that's what really happens. It's just a group of people trying to work on a side but even the parties, I think in Washington State, they don't ask us what our concerns are. The leadership decides, and they say, oh, this is how we're going to stand on such and such an issue.
I got to go, but can I just mention a couple things? Jim, I guess you and I are going to talk at some point. Lloyd, I'd like to talk to you about nonviolence at some point. It's a really important thing to me. I try and frame everything that I do in terms of nonviolence, and I don't think that we talk about that enough. I'm not sure that the dialogue arena is really exactly the place to talk about it, but I think it's I'd love to share your ideas and think about it together with you. So it's a challenge. It's a challenge to do that right. Anyway, thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you, Scott.
Before Scott goes, one other point. When he recorded his book in my closet, he made it look like a blanket fort that we made when we were kids.
He did.
You guys must have had a lot of fun.
And it worked.
Yeah, it was very good.
He was at work the whole time. It took me 10 days, and it was more of a nightmare than fun.
Scott, I'd like to just comment quickly. I also would really like us to look at it from an NBC perspective, because an awful lot of the notion of getting deeper behind what people, their initial presentation of their views, which can be quite upsetting and off-putting, but getting down under that to where the real needs and the real values are, feels to me like an essential element in what we're doing.
Yeah, I think that's one of the reasons why I emphasize listening so much, is the talking part comes really naturally, and
the
listening part is really, 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 really tough, and it's transformative, and not just transformative for us. This is the thing that people don't think about, is this is mainly a subconscious event. So listening establishes a bridge, and the bridge is very much enables two-way communication, whether you're speaking your truth or not. And that's why I literally never think about trying to get across my ideas anymore. The only time I ever do is when somebody really shocks me and I'm tired and I kind of go, are you kidding me? Oh my God. But other than that, I don't go there anymore. And I think that's largely a result of really trying to look at things through that nonviolent lens and understanding what's really going on, which is that my unconscious mind has to link with that other one. And I've got all this stuff inside that I don't know about that's driving me, and I don't want that to happen. Anyway.
All very complex.
Good night, y'all.
I need to go to wonderful.
Bye-bye.
Check it out again next month and see where we go.
Take care. Thank you all.
Thank you to everyone.
Bye-bye.
Have a good evening.